theory about growth, but they're still not quite recognizing the subtleties of the impact of different kinds of food. It's also much easier for kids to recognize growth in an incremental direction. So if you ask them about growing taller or getting heavier, it's easy. If you ask them about getting thinner or not growing, they have a harder time. It's like they have an easier time with growth processes that increase. And that's not surprising, because if you look at some of the earlier infancy literature on growth, you know, kids by the time they're two recognize things like between the difference between living and non-living things. Like, you don't have to tell your two-year-old or your three-year-old that, you know, if you cut your cat's fur, it's gonna grow back. Kittens grow bigger, puppies grow bigger, they don't grow smaller. And they also seem to recognize that if you do it to an inanimate object, if you cut your doll's hair, it's not gonna grow back. And parents are not explaining this to them. So they seem to understand that living things grow it incrementally, like, you know, in a positive direction. Like, weight gain is positive, but it is it's in an increasing direction, not in a decreasing direction. So it could be because they have this core biological theory early on that it's almost from a genetic evolutionary standpoint that eating is for survival, survival equals growth. But it's only at about fourth grade that they make this differentiation about the difference between healthy and unhealthy foods. So unfortunately, although parents are telling their kids a lot of things about eating, when they're left to make choices on their own, they're not quite applying it to heighten weight yet, and when they're younger. They might do it a little when they're a little bit older, but at this point, we're not seeing any kind of clear differentiation. So what does this mean in a bigger context? It means input is still important, because the input eventually does sort itself out by the time they're in third or fourth grade. But some of the other drawbacks of a study like this, which, you know, is really important to realize, is the foods. Like, the foods that I presented here are a lot, especially the unhealthy foods. The unhealthy foods could be really attracting kids. You know, I had some kids when I was testing these kids saying, when I said, what does Peter here eat? What do you think Peter here eats? And the child would say, well, Peter here eats chocolate chip cookies, pizza, chips, and a burger, because that's what I really like to eat. You know, so they would attribute it to themselves, and I'd be like, no, not you, but this character here. What does this person here like to eat? And they would say the same thing, because these foods are so attractive to kids that personal valence towards them, they can't separate it from what they like. And so that's a problem with a study like this, which is why you often just have forced choice responses, like, you know, cookies or broccoli or ice cream and that kind of thing. When you give them something like this, sometimes children will forget about the character and pick the foods they want to eat. So that's something that you have to kind of, it's a limitation of the study, unfortunately, that you have to kind of account for when you get some of these responses. So overall, you know, the input is not quite translating into appropriate biological output yet. They do know that it helps them grow, but that's about it. They're not making any kind of healthy differentiation. So that's pretty much the end of my talk. So, you know, in terms of acknowledgments, Lowry, you know, is where I go to do most of my research, and then some surrounding preschools. Future directions for this, one area that has not really been explored at all is paternal input. What do fathers talk to their kids about? Okay, there have been observations, for example, mothers at the dinner table say, eat it, it's good for you. Fathers, it's more fun, eating is fun. Like, you know, they'll say, eat it, look, I'm eating it. Or they'll, you know, you'll have to come up with a novel way to get your kids to eat their vegetables, things like that. But they're not talking about nutritional input and growth. So what do fathers, if you put fathers and their kids together, what kind of input are they going to give their kids about food? It's very hard to recruit fathers into the lab. That's one of the reasons you don't see paternal input studies. Also, how do these behaviors change with age? Like, we know that preschoolers, for example, don't recognize the importance of healthy or unhealthy eating. They attribute it to growth. But how do they change as they get older? A study that I'm just starting now, which actually in the fall, will be about activities, because one of the biggest things that impacts obesity is physical exercise. And all the literature has been just about eating. You know, you gotta eat healthy, it's good for growth and stuff. But what about parents talking to their children about getting physical exercise? You never hear kids I mean, parents talk to their kids about, well, you know, running's good for you because, you know, it makes you healthy. Or, you know, running's good for you, so you're fit, that kind of a thing. It seems like that's, and even pediatricians don't talk about it that much. It's all about what does your child eat. So the activities, the impact of different activities on weight is also something that I'm interested in, because that's also really, there's another component which is not being explored at all. Finally, you know, all of this research is, the biggest limitation of it, apart from the foods and everything that I present, is our socioeconomic status. Like, we do it with middle class, primarily white Caucasian populations. How does this change with, say, lower socioeconomic groups or with minorities? You know, what are the kind of things they tell their kids? Do they give such detailed explanations, or do they just say, eat your food? You know, it's your food, you can't waste it, you need to eat it, and so on. And that's something that really would be worth exploring, because you see a lot of obesity in lower socioeconomic groups and minority populations. So it's a very relevant topic for that group. But, you know, there's, again, it's very hard to do research with that population, hard to recruit and so on, but it's much needed in that area. So that's pretty much it for my talk. Are there any questions? Yeah.
So I was thinking, in your study paradigm, did you notice that there was just the children were just, say, they were eating more fruits in general? So like chips, but also broccoli and apples.
Yes. Sometimes they would just pick all eight foods.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, what do they eat? Oh, they eat all of them. This. No. Because that's the easy. That's why these open-ended things are so tricky. Because if you don't tell them you can pick more than one food, they just pick one food and sit there.
Right.
And then you'd say, oh, okay. So is that it? No. Okay, you can pick more foods. Then they'll pick all eight.
Right.
And so it's really hard. And you can't, you know, you should be telling them, like, you can't say, oh, no, you only got to pick a few, because that would be influencing your study. But at the same time, how do you get it? That's why I'd always say, you can pick more than one food if you want in the very beginning. But that, some kids just wouldn't get it, because when they're four or five, and of course they're drawn to the unhealthy foods,
right,
because that's what they like to eat. And so that is a problem with something like this. But for me, all this research is not valuable in the sense that it's in an artificial environment. Do you know what I'm saying? When you're giving them a questionnaire and asking them questions, doesn't reflect their real world behavior. You know, so if they have the choice to pick what they want to eat, what would they pick? And clearly, you know, kind of at that age, they're drawn, even though they get a lot of good input about healthy eating, they tend to gravitate towards the unhealthy foods as well.
So I don't know if this paradigm has been done, where instead of having them pick individual foods, what about like a plate that's, I don't know what like the latest, like.
Yeah, I'm actually doing that study, but I'm doing the study that's alternating it with healthy and unhealthy foods. So what we have is like spaghetti and milk and vegetables, and then we have unhealthy foods like donuts, juice, and maybe chicken nuggets. So we say, Mary here eats this every day, and show them a healthy platter, and then we show them another kid eats an unhealthy, who's going to grow taller.
Right, so it's a meal difference.
It's a meal difference, rather than, I'm just like working on wrapping that study up, you know, so that's currently what we're doing. And then the flip side to that study is about activities, sedentary versus physically active activities. You know, Peter here, or, you know, rides his bike every day. Paul here doesn't ride a bike at all, or something, or Paul colors every day, or something like that. So we're trying to see also with activities, do kids realize that with sedentary activities, you're more likely to put on weight than with active activities, and so on. And kids don't get much input at all about activities.
Did you have a question? I was just curious if there's ever any studies on the relationship that the mother and child has in talking about how they feel when they physically feel. Because I've noticed just with my own kids that I give them so much nutritional information, but you know, and they, you know, they believe you and they get it, but at, you know, at certain ages, they're gonna wanna grab the pizza because it tastes good. But then they also end up with a stomach ache. So they seem to make better choices the more they're aware of how food makes them feel.
So you mean the consequences of eating too much of something or eating
or
something?
Or just eating like pizza versus, I don't know, like say a healthy pizza or something. It's
right.
How your body feels. Like, it seems like an easier concept for kids to grasp.
You mean, so the children, mothers talk about how foods will make them feel?
Yeah.
Yeah, like that's that one thing they said, you know, that kid said, I don't eat too many apples, it'll give me a stomachache.
Yeah.
So either he's eaten too much and gotten a stomachache, or his mother has told him at some point that it's going to make him sick. Mm-hmm. You know, and our concept, and you know, parents also tell their kids, don't eat too much, you're gonna throw up.
Yeah.
You know, don't eat until you make yourself sick. You know, stop eating when you're full. That's the other thing. So there is some of that conversation too, about the psychological effects of that, psychological slash physical or biological effects of that.
Yeah.
So there haven't been any, in fact, there hasn't been any studies that has even documented mother-child conversations about eating.
That's really interesting.
Yeah, it's nothing has been, it's just, yeah, so far.
I feel like a lot of people talk about it. And like, do you think that as they get older, they will? Like, I think sometimes parents don't
think. I think peers become so influential as kids get older.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, like in middle childhood, you know, they get so influential, so they're really drawn to what their peers eat,
yeah,
and stuff like that. But I think a lot of the times it's like you'll talk about whatever you need to do to get your kids to eat their food. If they
yeah.
don't, if they're resisting a certain kind of food, you know, you might come up with innovative ways to get your kids to eat their broccoli or whatever it is. But it might not be all nutritional. Your kid couldn't care less if you said, right? You know, eat
yeah.
this, it's good for you, it is vitamin. The thing that's why they focus on physiological, you'll grow big and strong.
Yeah.
You'll grow tall.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff, which is not always true either.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the other thing too. Any other questions?
So was the food on the platter, was it actual food? Could it did it have an olfactory?
No, it was just a picture of the platter, yeah, of the foods. Yeah, so we just gave them pictures of the kids, pictures of the foods. I really don't think they eat real foods when they see pizza or when they see, you know, like something that's unhealthy that they like. Yeah, so it was just common foods that they would eat.